Velar, Velar not. I'm Jay.
I'm Steph.
And this is Modern Motoring.
Today we're high rolling in the 2024 Range Rover Velar, and this is the HSE trim, and you're making faces already, so I guess you've got something to say.
You go on. It's refreshed. Barely. Mm. I don't see the refresh on the outside. It's got a new screen, which we'll get into in a couple minutes, but there are three engine choices. You can get the P250 with the power in the mid twos through a 2-liter turbo, and the P340 with the 3-liter six cylinder, and that has power figures in the mid threes, or you can get what we have here, the P400, which has power in the high threes, well, 394 and 406. Everything's through an 8-speed automatic transmission.
That's pretty good off the top of your head.
I just wrote the notes like half an hour ago.
Good job.
There is a lot wrong with this. There is an immense number of questionable and puzzling decisions to do with this entire vehicle. I'm going to start with the most obvious thing and the most detrimental thing that would stop me from even looking twice at it.
Okay.
The ridiculous infotainment system.
Really? I was actually going to say that this version of the Pivi Pro system is not as offensive as some of the past ones. I don't actually mind it. And they've taken the screen that was down here and they've pulled all those functions up into this one screen, which I think, I kind of missed that screen that was down there. It was kind of funky, but it makes more sense to have everything centralized if you're going to put everything on screens.
There are four physical buttons between the instrument cluster and the gear selector.
Uh-huh.
The start-stop button, the hazards, the physical button you push down to park the vehicle,
uh-huh,
and the gear release switch.
Yeah.
That's it. Every other single thing is through this ridiculous slow screen.
Apparently that's what we want.
No, it's not. Not from Jaguar, not from Land Rover.
Okay.
Imagine being a company that is known for terrible, awful, horrible, glitchy, failing electronics, and then making everything based off that.
We're holding no punches today, apparently.
No, it's ridiculous. there's no need for it, and I'll tell you why. In the rear, for their climate control, they got the dials.
Mm.
The ones from where you can push them in to get your heated seats.
Mm-hmm.
We know they didn't throw away all those parts.
Right.
It's slow. My eyes have to come off the road for everything. Mm-hmm. There's no memory here. There's no haptic feedback to change the direction of the air, to change my drive modes, to change every single thing. It's through this.
Yeah.
I thought that the Mustang Mach-E had a terrible infotainment system. I thought the Volvo Everythings had a terrible infotainment. I thought Subaru, who's supposed to be the safest company out there with their eyesight business and their 95% of everything sold in the last 10 years is on the road, I thought their stuff was garbage. Making everything screen-based, and then you can't look away because it dings at you. This, all new low.
Oh, wow, okay.
There is nothing except a gear selector here.
I guess it's a matter of it being a refresh and partway through a generation, it's pretty complicated to do a lot of rewiring under here.
Fine.
So, yeah.
Now, your volume is on the steering wheel, which is nice. It is at the furthest point for me to reach.
Yeah, I don't like the steering wheel setup at all.
Well, too bad.
This is a Land Rover Range Rover thing, putting the volume on the right side. We did a video on this a couple years ago, and people were flooding our comment section saying, no, it's not because it's a British company, and usually people drive on the left. It's because it's for the passenger, because the driver has access to that feature on the steering wheel. I'm old school. I still have a habit of reaching with my hand to somewhere in this neighborhood when if I'm behind the steering wheel to change the volume. It's one of those sort of muscle memory things that will never go away.
You want to talk about where the rear USB ports are? Just like the CX-50 from Mazda, nobody's safe today. Mm. It's behind the armrest. So you have three people in that back seat, no one's getting USB ports. Mm. Ridiculous.
Well, since we've thoroughly eviscerated the infotainment system and the technology, what else would you like to target today?
The ridiculous engine that is only good for me over 80 kilometers an hour.
Okay, can I take this one? Because you've done your fair share of ranting today.
Did we say it's the 8-speed automatic all-wheel drive, 3-liter turbocharged inline. Oh, mild hybrid. That's the part that I missed.
Yes, you did miss that.
Okay, right. But it's a belt-driven mild hybrid, so you may as well not even have it. I'm done for now. Over to you.
Okay. I will start with a positive, because that's what we do.
Like a compliment sandwich.
Yes, exactly.
Fine.
When you get up to speed, the amount of power is good.
It is more than good.
More than good. It's probably more than most people need. Frankly, the 340 is probably good enough for the vast majority of drivers. It's getting to that is just unpleasant. Unpleasant. The throttle feels so heavy and sluggish. It's just a drag to get up to speed in this thing. The suspension doesn't feel great, but that's forgivable because Range Rovers are not designed for road driving, really. It's like a really, really fancy Wrangler, right? It's underneath, this thing is supremely capable, but how many people who buy this are actually going to use it for that on a regular basis?
Well, they did scoop out the rear end a little bit, which I guess is the same from the previous year, and there's the standard on the P400 electronic air suspension. I think it's standard all around, but this has it. You can adjust your ride height.
Yeah.
But I don't know, downshifting, not me downshifting, the car downshifting is just, it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
It stutters, it's not sure what it wants to do. I have something completely unrelated.
Okay.
I didn't tell you on purpose. I wanted to get your actual reaction.
Okay.
So someone here likes Rush.
Yes.
Which is fine. Someone here took a while to get into them.
Mm-hmm.
These little paddles?
Yes.
I'm 99% sure that they're tuned to the same bell as YYZ.
Really? That's exactly it.
Right? And that is like one of the only redeeming qualities. Is here, do it. Do it on the paddle shifter on the right side.
That's hilarious.
See?
Yeah.
Like, at least they got the aluminum. I don't think we can do more than that because we'll get dinged for copyright.
Yeah.
So let's talk about some of the maybe more pleasant things.
Okay.
So standard safety isn't great by 2024 standards, but it is great by Land Rover, Range Rover standards.
Right, so let's run through that really quickly. You have blind spot monitoring, rear cross traffic alert, adaptive cruise control, lane keep assist, and front parking sensors.
Front and rear.
Front and rear, excuse me. That's FR in your notes.
Oh,
front rear. Got it.
You do get a lot of standard features. So you get heated seats, you get cooled seats, you get a heated steering wheel, you get the Windsor leather seats, a Meridian audio, which is not the Meridian 3D audio you've got to pay extra for, panoramic roof, and wireless charging.
Yeah. The leather's nice, I'll give them that. It's a really, really nice feel to it. It's supple, I hate that word, but everybody uses it for leather. However, I do have something to say about the seats. Because I took this for 2 hours to go pick my kid up from camp up north, in Canada. If you're from here, you know what that means. So after about 90 minutes, and that's it, I was like, oh, my back.
Really?
Yeah, it was really uncomfortable. And I tried playing with the lumbar support. I could not find a seating position that was comfortable for me at all. And on top of that, I don't know what it is. Well, I do know what it is. I have short little legs, and we've talked about this before. But I cannot, in this vehicle, find a seating position where I can have the steering wheel a safe distance from my torso and have my foot holding on the brake at an intersection without having to hover my foot.
Weird.
Yeah. Oh, and also, the throttle is too close to the middle. Have you noticed that? I have wide feet, so I didn't know if that was me, but I tap the side of the center console every time I push the throttle. It's ridiculous.
And not quite as bad, but up there in the bad column, the auto start stop sensitivity. My foot stays perfectly still and it goes on and off. Like, no. Oh, is it because their electronics have been known to be just plain bad? Let's go into what happened 2 days ago. So today's July 14th, and this video should be up in the next couple of days. So on Friday, they announced JLR, Jaguar Land Rover, that Jaguar is wiping out everything. So all that's left is the F-Pace, which shares a platform with this.
Yeah.
So no more XE, which wasn't in Canada anyway, no more XF, no more E-Pace, which was ridiculous, and no more I-Pace.
Which is fine. The I-Pace
like Jaguar said, we're doing this to focus on electric vehicles. They have.
Yeah, no, but the I-Pace was revolutionary for what it was at this time, but it really didn't take long for it to be dated, and it was ready. It was ready to go.
So, I say that to say puzzlingly, nothing from the Land Rover side was cut. Mm-hmm. They kept the Evoque, they kept this. The 2025s are on sale now.
Yeah.
On their website, which is weird because we just got this, and the Range Rover Sport and the Range Rover and all the Defenders, like nothing got.
Well, if we're gonna get into analyzing this, Land Rover is we should say Range Rover now, because we don't even use the Range Rover for certain vehicles. It's now three different brands.
It's so weird.
They can't seem to find what exactly they want their identity to be, but we do know that everything under the Range Rover line is SUVs, and that's all people want right now. And their initial idea was that Jaguar was going to be a mixed brand and Range Rover was going to be their SUV brand. Well, we see Jaguar dying.
Dead.
And so, pretty well dead. We'll see what comes with their decision to go into more electrics, but...
Including their Halo $170,000 vehicle. Anyway, more on that later.
Anyway, this was predictable, is what I'm saying, because if you're going to have an SUV brand where all of your purchases and attention go into, and then you try to keep something alive more or less with cars, these days that's just not going to fly.
So with that, we'll talk about what we have here as far as price goes. So the MSRP for the HSE, which is our trim here, is $88,500. If you want the SE, it's $68,450. So about $20,000 worth of difference. As tested, $102,545. And some of those add-ons include $1,950 for delivery. I think $1,000 for that Meridian 3D audio system, which doesn't sound too bad. $1,700 for 22-inch wheels. You get a 19-inch spare underneath the trunk, $1,450 for a tech pack, which is your head-up display, 360 cam, and your weight sensing business, $1,700 for a gray paint job, Zadar gray, and a few others. Overpriced by 30%.
Yeah. Okay, so are we summing up?
No, let's do the competitor thing.
Okay. I can do the competitor thing in a sentence.
No, we should at least go through it.
No, I don't need to. Like, I can tell you what all the competitors are. I can tell you I would pick every single one of them over this.
Let's list them off.
All right.
At the very least. So there's the BMW X3, Mercedes GLC.
Yeah, and it's the 43 that would be a better match to this one than, say, the 350 with the engine that we're working with here.
And same thing with the X3. It's the M340i. 340i, sorry.
Yeah.
No, M340i.
What planet BMW. Is somebody choosing this over an M40i? I don't know.
People have brand loyalty.
Yeah.
You have the Q5, you have the F-Pace, obviously you got the F-Pace.
Yeah.
XC60, you have the GV70, and the Stelvio.
And the XT5, even if you want to go into the Cadillac side of things. I try really hard to find at least one buyer profile that makes sense for every car we test. There's always somebody who it makes sense for them to choose a vehicle. I can't find that in this car, and that's rare. Like, I've been really trying to find something that makes me think, yes, this is the perfect car for this person. I don't believe it exists in this vehicle. I'm sorry, I'm not a Range Rover hater. I like the Defender a lot. I like the new Range Rovers a lot. They command a high price, and they're worth it. I don't see it in this car at all.
So I would do a corporate lease. This would have to be my third, fourth, fifth, sixth product from Land Rover. And I would take this as a last gasoline version before the EVs come out in the next 2 to 3 years. But that's a stretch. It's not the car for us.
No.
Likely not the car for a lot of people, but it might be the car for somebody. Maybe.
Let's leave it there, I guess.
Let's leave it there.
Yes, thank you so much for watching. If you haven't already, please hit that button down there that lets you subscribe for our very honest reviews so that you don't miss any more of them. And we are on all the major social media channels, so you please reach out, and we'd love to hear from you. Thanks for watching.